Did Paul write to the little flock? And if so, what did he write to the little flock? So let's start in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. 2 Peter and chapter 3, verse 15. And account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. So now 2 Peter 3:15 is obviously part of 2 Peter, and it's obvious from 2 Peter chapter 1 that 2 Peter is written by Peter. And so the you, we'll see who the you here is that is mentioned in 2 Peter 3:15, but it's obvious that Paul has written unto you, whoever that is. Well, turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them, this is going to tell us who Peter was writing to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. So Peter is writing in 2 Peter to those that have obtained like precious faith with us. In other words, Peter was writing to some folks that had the same faith that he did. And so what seems to be the case is that Peter is writing to the kingdom church. He is writing to the little flock. If you think about Galatians chapter 2, verses 7 through 9, we know that Paul had a ministry to the uncircumcision. Peter had a ministry to the circumcision. And so Peter's ministry was to the kingdom church. It was to the little flock. So in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, it seems that Peter is addressing them of like precious faith. He's writing to kingdom saints. So what that would then seem to suggest is that in 2 Peter 3:15, let's look at it again. 2 Peter 3 and 15. Even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. So Paul wrote to the same people that Peter was writing to. So did Paul write something to the kingdom church? Did he write something to the little flock? Based upon 2 Peter 3:15, it seems that there is something that was written to them. But we have to figure out what was written to them. It doesn't say that Paul wrote everything to them. It says there was something written to them. And in fact, look with me at verse 15 and 16 together. You'll notice that verse 15 doesn't end with a period, it ends with a semicolon, so we have to complete the thought. So let's read it together. 2 Peter 3:15, an account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you, as also in all his epistles. So in other words, Paul wrote some other epistles. The one that he wrote to the you, the folks that are being addressed in 2 Peter 3, was different from what he wrote to other individuals. If you read the whole, if you read 2 Peter 3:15 and 3:16, it's making it clear that he's written unto them as also in all his epistles. In other words, what he wrote to them was somehow different from what Paul typically wrote. And that makes sense because we know that Paul was the apostle of the Gentiles, and we know that his ministry was to the body of Christ. And so that is who his epistles are addressed to. But there is this unusual thing in 2 Peter 3:15 where he's written unto you. So now the question becomes, what exactly was it that Paul wrote unto the little flock? Well, we can learn more about the you that Paul was writing to. So look with me at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. Well, the you in verse 1 is the same you as verse 15. It's the kingdom church, the little flock. You'll notice that what Peter says here is this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. That means that Peter must have written a prior epistle if this is the second epistle. Well, this epistle is 2 Peter. You can probably guess, what's the prior epistle that Peter wrote unto them? Well, we obviously that would be 1 Peter. So what 2 Peter 3:1 does, just notice this before we turn to 1 Peter, it says, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. So the people that were addressed in 2 Peter are the very same people that were addressed in 1 Peter. So now what we can do is we can turn to 1 Peter, and we're going to learn some things about who Paul was writing to. 1 Peter, who Peter was writing to. I think the studio audience sometimes has to correct me because I mistakenly say things that are wrong. So 2 Peter is written by Peter, and 1 Peter is written by Peter. And you know that because the first verse says it. And what we just saw in 2 Peter 3, verse 1, is that 2 Peter is written to the same audience as 1 Peter. This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. Now look at me at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. So this is instructive. We saw in 2 Peter that Peter was writing to the kingdom church, the little flock. We also know that 2 Peter was addressed to the same audience as 1 Peter. 1 Peter tells us specifically who it was written to. It was the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. 1 Peter and 2 Peter have the exact same audience. So now, if you would look with me, let's understand where these places are. So we're going to spend a little time here looking at the map, and we're going to find Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. So let's do Pontus first. And this is just a map of Paul's travels. Pontus, you can see, is up here in the top right corner. That's Pontus. Then we need to find Galatia. Galatia is right there. Then we have to find Cappadocia. Cappadocia is right there. Now we have to find Asia. Asia is right here. And now we have to find Bithynia. Bithynia is right here. So if we look at Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, it's all right here. You can see that, right? It's all in that same region, okay? So 1 Peter is written to the kingdom church, the little flock that is in this region right here. 2 Peter, this second epistle, and let me make sure I just quote this exactly as it says, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. 2 Peter was written to the exact same group of people. So both 1 Peter and 2 Peter are addressed to people in that region right there. Now notice something with me in 1 Peter 1 verse 1 before we move on. It says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. It wasn't written to just one of those locations. It was written to all of those locations. So now we can see something. Peter wrote to that region of those five locations. When 2 Peter 3:15 talks about our beloved brother Paul hath also written unto you, the you is the same you. So in other words, Paul must have written something to the folks in those regions. But that's very helpful, because now what that allows us to do is all we have to do is we can look at Paul's epistles and we can carefully study what they say, and we can figure out which of Paul's epistles was written to this entire region. And when we figure out which of Paul's epistles is written to that entire region, that's going to be a very helpful clue as to what 2 Peter 3:15 is referring to. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go through Paul's epistles in order, and we're going to figure out which one of them is written to the strangers scattered throughout all of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Whatever Paul wrote to all five of those regions, that's what 2 Peter 3:15 would seem to be referring to. So let's start with Romans. Romans was written to the church where? Does anyone have a guess? Well, Romans was written to the church at Rome. The church at Rome is right there. So now here is the, you remember in like grade school when they gave you maps and you, they would test your knowledge of how maps work. So here's my question for you. Is Rome within Cappadocia? Yes or no? Let's go with no. Is it in Galatia? Is it in Pontus? Is it in Bithynia? Is it in Asia? It is not. So is Romans what Peter was referring to in 2 Peter 3:15? It can't be. It's the wrong place. Well, what about 1 Corinthians? Well, 1 Corinthians is, of course, written to the church at Corinth. The church at Corinth is right there. Is Corinth in this region? It's not. It's far, far away. So 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians cannot be what Peter was referring to in 2 Peter 3:15. Galatians. Now, this one is interesting. Galatians was written to whom? Well, turn with me to Galatians 1. Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 1. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. And all the brethren which are with me, unto the churches of Galatia. Grace be to you, and peace from God the Father, and from our Lord Jesus Christ. So Galatians, which Paul wrote, is addressed to the churches of Galatia. But is it addressed to the strangers in Cappadocia? No. Is it addressed to strangers in Pontus? No. Is it addressed to strangers in Bithynia? No. Is it addressed to strangers in Asia? You see the point? In other words, 1 Peter 1 specifically said that Peter wrote to the strangers scattered throughout all five of those regions. And so we're looking for something that Paul would have written to all five of those regions. Galatians doesn't fit the bill, because it is specifically addressed to only one of the five. So Galatians can't be what's referenced in 2 Peter 3:15. What comes after Galatians? The book of Ephesians. Well, the book of Ephesians is sort of interesting, because where is Ephesus? Well, Ephesus is located in Asia. And it is eluding me on the map here. It's hiding from me. There we go. Ephesus is right there. So Ephesus is in Asia and is described as in Asia in the scriptures. But look with me at Ephesians 1:1. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now, 1 Peter, again, was written to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Ephesians is written not even to all of Asia. It's written to the saints at Ephesus. So Ephesians, which is focused here, doesn't include this entire region. So Ephesians can't be the answer to 2 Peter 3:15. So what comes after Ephesians? Philippians, of course. Well, where is Philippi? So the Philippians resided in Philippi. And if you look at Philippi, it's in Macedonia. It's far away from the region we're looking at. So Philippians can't be what 2 Peter 3:15 is talking about. What about Colossae or Colossians? So after Philippians, there's Colossians. Colossae is right here, but obviously that's not the answer either. 1 Thessalonians. Well, 1 and 2 Thessalonians are both written to the church at Thessalonica. Thessalonica is in Macedonia, and that can't be what 2 Peter 3:15 is talking about. So 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians can't be the answer. What comes after 2 Thessalonians? 1 Timothy. Well, 1 Timothy is written to a person. It's not written to the stranger scattered throughout those five regions. So 1 Timothy can't be the answer. 2 Timothy can't be the answer. Titus is written to an individual. Philemon is written to an individual. So notice what we've done. We've gone over all 13 of Paul's epistles, and none of them are written to anything like this entire region, right? So we looked at Romans. Rome is here. We looked at 1 Corinthians. Corinth is here. 2 Corinthians. Corinth is here. We looked at Galatians, but Galatians isn't addressed to the entire region. It specifically says the churches of Galatia. It doesn't say anything about Cappadocia, Bithynia, Pontus, Asia. So Galatians is out. Ephesus happens to be in Asia, but Ephesians isn't addressed to all of Asia, and it's not addressed to Galatia, Cappadocia, Bithynia, or Pontus. So it can't be Ephesus. Philippians is addressed to Philippi, so it can't be that. Colossians is addressed to the saints at Colossae. That can't be it. 1 and 2 Thessalonians is addressed to the church at Thessalonica. That clearly can't be it. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, Philemon, they're not the strangers scattered. So what did we find? We took the scriptural criteria from 2 Peter and 1 Peter, which said that those epistles were addressed to the little flock scattered throughout this entire region. And 2 Peter 3:15, even as our beloved brother Paul hath written unto you. But when we looked at every single one of Paul's epistles, none of them are written to people in that area. So what's the answer? Is 2 Peter 3:15 just wrong? Is it an error? Is it a mistake? Because clearly, none of the epistles that Paul wrote are written to people in that region. Well, I'm going to suggest to you there's a different answer, and it's actually a fairly straightforward answer. Paul did write to the little flock in this entire region, but it's not included within the canon of Scripture. In other words, Paul must have written something to them because Peter says, even as our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. So Paul must have written something, but it's not something that's in the Bible. Now, does that bother you? Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Now, you know that Paul was a Pharisee. You know that his ministry during the book of Acts and after the book of Acts lasted for years and years and years. Do you think that during that time there were only 13 things that Paul wrote, that there was nothing else that he penned? That would seem hard to believe, wouldn't it? And in fact, look what 1 Corinthians 7 tells us. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, or 1 Corinthians 5, I'm sorry, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, excuse me. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 9, I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators. Paul says, I wrote unto you in an epistle, not to company with fornicators. Well, what did Paul write to Corinth prior to 1 Corinthians? If you read 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, it's very obvious that 1 Corinthians is written before 2 Corinthians, because in 2 Corinthians, Paul refers to events that occurred in 1 Corinthians. So 2 Corinthians can't be the epistle that Paul's referring to. What 1 Corinthians 5:9 tells you is Paul wrote a letter to Corinth prior to 1 Corinthians, and it's not included in the Scriptures. It's not anywhere. You can look at all of Paul's epistles, and you can look at 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy and Titus and Philemon and so on and Philippians. None of those match the description of a prior epistle that Paul wrote unto Corinth. What does that tell us? Well, what that tells us is this. Not everything that Paul wrote was inspired. Not everything that Paul wrote was something that the Holy Spirit decided to preserve. There were other things that Paul wrote that the Holy Spirit decided not to include in the canon. An example of that, which we know for a fact, this is not opinion, this is fact, there was an epistle that Paul wrote to Corinth. 1 Corinthians 5:9 tells you that, and it was before 1 Corinthians, and it's not in the Scriptures. There were things Paul wrote that are not in the Scriptures. So we shouldn't be troubled by 2 Peter 3:15 when it talks about Paul writing something unto those kingdom saints, because he did write something unto those kingdom saints, but it wasn't Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, or Philemon. It can't be any of those things because they don't match the description. Instead, it was an epistle that was useful for those kingdom saints, but it was not something that the Holy Spirit decided to preserve in the Scriptures. Now I'm going to give you another reason why that might make sense. So think with me just for a minute. What happens during the book of Acts is that Israel diminishes. And we understand that the book of Acts is a transition time. It is a transition from the kingdom program being in effect in partway through the book of Acts, the dispensation of grace is instituted. When you get to the end of the book of Acts, Israel has diminished and fallen, and there is no difference between Jew and Greek. As opposed to time past when Israel was God's chosen people and Gentiles were described as without hope, things are different during the dispensation of grace. Now think through this with me. It makes a lot of sense why the Holy Spirit would not have preserved what Paul wrote to the little flock that's described in 2 Peter 3:15. The first reason that is, does the little flock exist today? Is there anywhere on earth where there's a little flock? There isn't. Because what happened by the end of the book of Acts is the Holy Spirit stopped putting people in to the little flock. What happened is today, if you're saved, you're in the body of Christ. If you're not in the body of Christ, you're not saved, because the only believing group today that God is forming is the body of Christ. He's not forming the little flock. Well, one of the reasons that the Holy Spirit may have chosen not to preserve what Paul wrote unto the little flock is that whatever he wrote was going to become obsolete and irrelevant very shortly, because what was going to happen to the little flock? It was going to simply cease to exist. When the Holy Spirit stopped putting people into the little flock, the existing members of the little flock would grow old, they would die, and the little flock would cease to exist. Now, it will be recreated when the prophetic clock resumes, but today there is no such thing as the little flock. And that might have been a reason why the Holy Spirit chose not to preserve whatever Paul wrote to the little flock that's described in 2 Peter 3:15. Now get with me 2 Peter 3:15 just for a minute. I want to show you something. Notice what Peter says about this. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. Now, think about this with me just for a minute. Let's hide the dispensation of grace. During the Lord's earthly ministry, he specifically said, "This generation shall not pass away till all these things be fulfilled." And what he was telling them was that the fulfillment of the prophetic program would happen within that generation. And if there was no dispensation of grace, that's exactly what would have happened. In Acts chapter 2, Peter stands up, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he says, "This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." In other words, what we're seeing here is the fulfillment of prophecy, and what Joel described was the last days. So you know, based upon Peter's statement in Acts 2, speaking by the Holy Ghost, you know by what the Lord said during his earthly ministry, that it was understood that the end was going to come within that generation. But what happens? Well, what happens is the prophetic scriptures stop being fulfilled. Why do they stop being fulfilled? Well, they stop being fulfilled because what God the Father decided to do is he decided to call a timeout. So think with me just for a moment. If this plays through, what would have happened is the 70th week would have come, judgment would have come, and the second coming would have occurred. And what God the Father decided to do, because he is a gracious, loving, long-suffering God, as he said, "I'm going to pause my wrath. I'm going to call a timeout. I'm putting the prophetic calendar on hold. I'm interrupting it, and I'm inserting the dispensation of grace." So far, that dispensation has lasted almost 2,000 years. It was a holding back. It was a delay. It was a putting on hold of the prophecy program. Now, that's a wonderful thing, because what that means is today you can be saved by grace through faith apart from works in an instant as a Gentile, and you don't have to join yourself to Israel. You don't have to get circumcised. Today is a very easy way for people to get saved. Now, the Lord had to shed his blood to do that, but you can have salvation as a free gift, and you don't have to join yourself to Israel. Hallelujah for the Lord's grace. But what would Israel think? What would believing Israel think, right? Because believing Israel was thinking, well, the 70th week is coming, and it should be here. I remind you what Peter says in 2 3:15, "An account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation." In other words, here's what's going on, folks. The reason why the prophetic scriptures have not been fulfilled is that God is long-suffering. He's not going to pour out his wrath. And you should account that, you should view that as salvation. In other words, God has given this opportunity for mankind to be saved. That's how you should think about it. And then notice what he immediately says, "Even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you." So he recognizes that Paul had wisdom, and he comments that Paul had written unto them. Now think about this with me just for a moment. If you were in the little flock at that time, would you have questions? Well, sure you would have questions, because here's what happened. Israel has been God's chosen people for a couple thousand years. They were specifically selected to be. And the prophetic program was about to be fulfilled. And what you notice is, wait a minute, the prophecies, they're not being fulfilled. And what's going on here with all these Gentiles being saved without joining themselves to Israel, without becoming part of the believing remnant? I mean, how? What's going on? Well, who would be the perfect person on the earth to explain this dispensational change? Paul. Paul was a Jew. Paul was familiar with the Old Testament scriptures. He was familiar with the kingdom program. He was familiar with the little flock, which he persecuted. As Peter says, wisdom was given unto him. Did he understand the dispensation of grace? Did he understand the prophetic program had been put on hold? Yes, he did. He understood all of those things, making Paul the perfect person to write to the little flock and explain, here's why the prophetic scriptures have been put on hold. Here's why prophecy has ceased to be fulfilled. And so that's what Peter is describing when he's describing Paul writing unto you. Yes, Paul wrote something to the little flock, but it wasn't Romans, it wasn't 1st or 2nd Corinthians, it wasn't Galatians, it wasn't Ephesians, it wasn't Philippians, it wasn't Colossians, it wasn't 1st or 2nd Thessalonians, it wasn't 1st or 2nd Timothy, it wasn't Titus, it wasn't Philemon, it wasn't any of those things. It was a different writing that the Holy Spirit chose not to preserve. Likely the reason the Holy Spirit chose not to preserve it is that that writing was of only temporary value, because what was going to happen to the little flock? They were going to become extinct. They were going to cease to exist. Now, look with me, if you would, at 2 Peter 3:15 again. Now, what I want you to notice here is that Paul was well suited to explain that to the little flock, and that appears to be exactly what he did. That reinforces the conclusion that Romans to Philemon was not written to the little flock. The only letter that is said to have been written to the little flock is something the Holy Spirit did not preserve in the canon of Scripture. It's not in your Bible today. Now notice what happens when you read 2 Peter 3:15 and 16 together. An account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. Notice this. As also in all his epistles, so he wrote something unto you, as also in all his epistles. The all his epistles is something else. It's Romans to Philemon, but he wrote something different to the little flock. Now notice what it says here. As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Right after the verse that describes what Paul wrote to the little flock, Scripture warns that there are those who are unlearned and unstable who will wrest the scriptures to their own destruction. What it's really warning about there is that sometimes people wrest Paul's writings. They don't treat them the way the Bible treats them. And when you see that occurring, what you're seeing is the people that wrest Paul's scriptures, according to that verse, they're unlearned, they're unstable, and they wrest them to their own destruction. It's a really important point that we need to keep in mind as we're studying Paul's epistles. Get with me Galatians chapter 6. I want to show you one more thing. Galatians chapter 6. And look with me at verse 16, Galatians 6:16. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. Now in Galatians 6:16, Paul makes specific reference to believing Israel. That is a reference to the kingdom church. It's the Israel of God, it's the little flock, it's believing Israel. And what that tells you is Paul knows how to refer to the little flock. When Paul wants to write something about the little flock, how does he do it? He just flat out tells you, right? When Galatians 6:16, when he wants to refer to the little flock, to the believing remnant in Israel, he specifically describes them, and upon the Israel of God. There's nothing there that you have to read into the text. You don't have to come up with private interpretations. When Paul is talking about the little flock, he specifically tells you, right? He uses a phrase like the Israel of God. And that's how you know that he's talking about the little flock. And here's how you know when he's not talking about the little flock, when he doesn't use a phrase like that. In other words, if Paul's talking about the little flock, he will describe them with something like the Israel of God. When he doesn't do that, then he's not talking about them. So what have we seen tonight? Let's wrap this together. 2 Peter 3:15. Peter says that our beloved brother Paul hath written unto you, and the you there is the little flock, and it's the little flock that is what? Scattered throughout this entire region. Peter wrote to the little flock scattered throughout that entire region because the little flock, the kingdom church, was the group that he ministered to. But in 2 Peter 3:15, he mentioned something else. He said, here's how you think about the long suffering of God. The reason why the kingdom program hasn't continued, the reason why prophecy hasn't been fulfilled, is that it is the long suffering of God. God has done this, and you should think about it in terms of salvation. And Paul wrote something unto them. He didn't write everything unto them. He didn't write Romans to Philemon unto them, but he wrote something separate to explain to the little flock that there was this dispensational change and how they should think about it. And what Paul wrote was no doubt a helpful letter, but it was not something that the Holy Spirit wanted to preserve. And you know that because it's not in the Scripture today. What Paul wrote to the little flock is something that the Holy Spirit didn't preserve. What Paul wrote to the body of Christ, Romans to Philemon, God did preserve, and you can find it in the canon today.